I'd like to thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being with me tonight. And for the music, I'd like to thank Mr. Nelson Riddle.
This is Jonathan Schwartz with Nelson Riddle.
I've got you under my skin.
The arrangement of I've Got You Under My Skin, do you recall any pre-arrangement conversation with Sinatra about it?
There must have been one. I don't recall it specifically, but I think he wanted a crescendo. I don't think he was aware of the way I was going to achieve that crescendo, but he certainly wanted an instrumental interlude which would be exciting and carry the orchestra up into the instrumental part and then come on down where he would finish it vocally. I know the evening that we did it, he expressed considerable enthusiasm for the arrangement, and I guess later on when he took the tape home and played it, why, he was even more enthusiastic. As it turned out, it was a sort of a cornerstone recording for both him and me.
You had 16 arrangements to write. Let's take it a step backwards. The songs, I've Got You Under My Skin, You Make Me Feel So Young, Our Love Is Here to Stay, How About You, Anything Goes. Did Sinatra and Sinatra only select those songs, or did he do it in collaboration with you and Voyle Gilmore, the producer?
Actually, Voyle presided as a benign presence. Voyle was very easygoing and a very pleasant man. Sinatra picked his own things. He has always, to my knowledge, picked things. I think he may once in a while listen to the suggestion of someone else. So when you hear a Frank Sinatra album, it's the product of Frank Sinatra's head. He's fairly versant with classical music, and he would give me many examples from classical music. And he'd say, I want this kind of a sound here and this kind of a sound here. There was one song that he wanted a Puccini sound behind him.
To love and be loved, that's what life's all about.
Well, now, anybody with half a thorough musical knowledge would immediately know what that was, but I had to go to the library and open a Puccini score because I had studiously avoided operatic music. I never liked the sound of the cultivated human voice when singing at all. But anyway, I found that what he meant by a Puccini sound was that the melody is doubled in octaves in the orchestra. And that's what he wanted. And when he heard it, he came right up to where the band was and he says, that's a beautiful arrangement. The thing is that he mapped out a lot of these things. He might have been specific in colorations at times, but at least he was very coherent about what he wanted, where the crescendi should take place, where the diminuendos, the tempo, naturally the key. And sometimes it became almost painful in discussing an album of 12 or 14 songs when you'd say, how much longer is this going to go on? Because it was a very precise, tense atmosphere. And I was taking, as they say, copious notes so that I could reconstruct this meeting later on.
Have you saved any of those notes?
They exist in the library where his music is, the librarian who has the music now, they also have a file there of lead sheets, song copies, and on those song copies are the notes. He would never know it, but I would practically blow my stack because we'd take almost an hour on each piece. And then human nature would set in. About after five or six or seven or eight of those, he'd get tired. He'd say, do what you want with the rest. I learned a lot from Frank about conducting for a vocalist. I learned the importance of tempos, which are as important as the colorations of the orchestra. Actually, tempos are another source of color in arrangements. Just as the addition of various instruments are, so are tempos, and so are dynamics. And I learned to have an orchestra breathe with him phrase by phrase.
This is an arrangement that has within it, particularly at the beginning, another trademark of yours, which has always seduced me, and that is your little oriental figure. Da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da. You've used it in many an arrangement, and this is a classic example of the oriental Nelson Riddle.
From this moment on, you for me, dear, she did. From this moment on.
Now, you were telling me, Nelson, about that what I call oriental figure. Define your terms.
Actually, I think, Jonathan, it comes from my obvious admiration of the French Impressionists. The French, Ravel, Debussy, they were fascinated by the characteristics of the music of another land, and it meant not anything at all to them to bridge the gap and use those characteristics for their own purposes. Debussy's Iberia has certain Spanish overtones in it, and certainly Ravel's Alborada de Graciosa. In, you know, in the Mother Goose suite, there's the Empress of the Pagodas, which is distinctly oriental, heard through the ears of a French impressionist.
It's interesting that you do mention Ravel and speak of your admiration for him. And I imagine, in a hackneyed kind of way, his most famous work has become, particularly because of that film, Ten, Bolero.
Mm-hmm.
And if Bolero has nothing else, it sure has a crescendo.
It most certainly does.
It is actually nothing but. And your crescendo, would you suggest that your admiration for Maurice Ravel's music could have helped you along the crescendo trail in your arrangements?
Both gentlemen relied on dynamics in their music, as all thinking composers do. They're as important as part of music. Once again, I said the tempi were another color. Well, certainly dynamics, of which crescendi is part, are very important. I remember when I was a high school boy in Ridgewood, New Jersey, my friend in the English class acquired two tickets to a Boston Symphony concert. And in 1936, we went over to Carnegie Hall, and we heard Serge Koussevitzky and the Boston Symphony perform Bolero. I've never forgotten it. It's almost as if the orchestra leaped from the stage and smacked you in the face. I think our tickets were in the balcony, so it was quite a leap. But it was most effective, and that it is the most calculating crescendo, the most calculatingly orchestrated. It's the most absolutely tantalizing slow addition of instruments to this long, long crescendo, which is really the message of the bolero. And it is excruciating in its deliberate, slow addition of pressure. Now that's sex in a piece of music.